I came in somewhat late last night, but I'm rested. Since she mentioned that book, Literacies, that I co-authored with Paulo Freire, I want to begin with a story that I hope will inspire all of us for you to situate and locate who this man Paulo Freire was, not only in terms of who he was as a writer, but who he was as a human being. I was trained in psycholinguistics. I knew very well how to split morphemes. I knew how to teach rules, that when to use the ED as a past tense, but I did not know that using the ED in the wrong context, you would be devalued, dehumanized, and relegated to special education, or to valid education, or to some other tracking they were following for the rest of your life. I was a mere translator of this book, Literacies, Reading the World and Reading the Word. Three chapters, Paulo had returned from exile, and the publisher was putting a lot of pressure, we want something new from you, we want something new from you, because he had written this classic book, Pedagogy of the Oppressed, that you all should read, that was banned in Brazil, you know, and in fact, Paulo was exiled, you know, for about 16, 17 years from Brazil for having written this book and for developing an approach where illiterate peasant could learn how to read, but not only learn how to read, most importantly, he used literacy to develop conscientization. So they become aware of who they are as agents of history, as agents of their reality. That in fact, because they are poor, that doesn't mean poverty becomes then a destiny. It's something that could be transformed, and you can engage in that. So there were no faxes. No, there was faxes. No emails. The telephone to Brazil was enormously expensive. I was, you know, happily getting by in the assistant professorship, you know, salary that I was getting from Boston University. And so I would translate, you know, chunks I would send to him, and then he would make the correction and mail back to me. Once in a while we would talk. So when I finished the three chapters, I also was very aware of the criticism against Paulo for those who didn't want to engage his critical and radical work and would say things like that Paulo's work is good, but for the third world, as if we don't have a third world in the first world reality. I can take you to East LA, I can take you to Roxbury, Massachusetts, I can take you to the Harlem, I can take you to South Chicago, on and on and on, that you find third world realities. And most of us in this room have, in fact, confronted that reality. So we're not going to buy that so easily. So then I suggested to him that perhaps, since our dialogues have been somewhat successful, we could do a dialogue to contextualize the three chapters, you know, for the North American audience. He was invited, he said, great, that's a great idea. I invite you to come and live, stay with me for about a month, which I did, in his apartment, and then we will work and do this dialogue, and then you come back and finish. And then in the summer, when I come to Boston College, where he was invited to teach, not by the School of Education, by the School of Theology. Remember, in those days, Paulo was more well known among activists, social workers, ministers, priests, and so on and so forth, than educators. In fact, at BU, if you wanted to read the Pedagogy of the Oppressed, if you went to the main library, they did not have it. You know, there was a reference, go to the School of Theology Library, which basically kept educators of the general population from reading Paulo Freire, unless you're a theologian. Then he came. I went into my dialogue, translated them, edited them, and then he came, I visited him, I gave him the manuscript. And then he said, I'm so tired. Long trip, 12 hours from Brazil. Why don't you come back tomorrow? Elsa will make a cafe joan, let them know, which is a typical traditional dish. Some traditional, like menudo, you know, for the Mexicans, yeah. And so, and he thought he was making more appealing for me to come. But the whole day, the whole night, I was nervous because I did not know that if he's going to be happy, in that I added a last chapter to sort of cover all of the movements of literacy that was somewhat big taking place in the United States, and I gave everything to him. But I always keep in mind that translator, I was very happy and honored to be a translator and nothing else. So as I come in and I say hello to Elsa, and then he says, come to my study. And he did, and he put the table, the chair, diagonally across from me, and then he had the manuscript. And he says, Donaldo, I have not written, but I'm writing this in the book that I'm, as an introduction to this book that I'm doing, The Color of Archaeology. He says, Donaldo, this manuscript talked to me last night. Matthew was about 33 years old, nervous, insecure. And I said, gosh, he doesn't like it. He says, Donaldo, this manuscript talked to me last night, and he had this intense eyes and looking at me, and I was becoming, you know, by the minute more nervous. And then he says, this manuscript talked to me and told me, Paulo, you are no longer my author. Then I thought I was going to die. Because I thought I had done so much that he didn't recognize his initial book. Now I shake anyhow. Then I was really shaking. And then he then repeated. He wrote it by telling stories. This is the brilliance of Paulo Freire. Then he said, Donaldo, this manuscript talked to me last night and told me, Paulo, if Donaldo Macedo is not the co-author, this manuscript will not be published. Can you believe the generosity, particularly in the United States, that we're fighting each other, who's going to be first in the publication, or who's going to be second, the level of competitiveness that we find in the academy, the lack of loyalty, you see, the lack of adherence or coherence to the project that we see all around us, you know, that makes us almost fall into cynicism, then to have this man, you know, a well-known figure, the most well-known educated in the world in the past 50 years or so, to ask a young assistant professor with few articles published to be his co-author, or else the book would not be published. This gives you an idea what we have to do in addition to learning about methods. That without that generosity, without coherence, without the commitment to certain principles of ethics, I'm not so sure that we will achieve and we will be able to see what the dean mentioned, a process through which we humanize education, a process through which we will begin to see, quote unquote, you know, people that we have mentored in positions of power, as Cristina just witnessed, and I happened to be there also, you know, in Washington, and then us, we all see as we go to various schools, various states, various conferences, see our students writing books now. directing dissertations and so forth. This is what teaching is all about. And it cannot be done individually. The writing is not done individually. You may fool yourself that, you know, you're the author. I am, because I wrote it. But it is a compilation of multiple texts that were shared with me, including influences, including help from people that you work with or that you live with. I don't write anything that goes up before Lilia, my partner, reads it, gives her input, or vice versa. This is how we need to begin to work collectively. So today, I am deeply happy to be here because I'm very fond of San Diego State University. It's not the first time that I have come here. But I am doubly glad that I was invited because the students are taking the initiative to be otherwise in order to think otherwise and to behave otherwise and transform what needs to be transformed, not the reform that we are, in a sense, you know, that has been imposed on us. Your commitment to students, in my view, the work that I have seen by many of you, particularly Alessandra, but I have a tendency to call you Alejandra, like our son Alejandro, whom I convinced last night that she's only going to teach for 2 years and then she's going to do her doctorate. And we have picked already the program. So, I do that because Paulo says education is directive. You know? So you gotta be a little pushy when you see talent in front of you and you wanna encourage that talent to go forward. Because as we are approaching the age of retirement, we wanna make sure there will be leaders to carry out the work that needs to be done. So I want to express my special thank you to you for organizing this event. Alessandra and her cohort, in my view, particularly the various conversations that I've had with her, you are yearning to redefine what it means to teach, what it means to be bilingual, and what it means to become in two languages without the risk of falling into what I often refer to a linguistic and cultural schizophrenia, that you separate the selves, you are in el barrio, you are fully one person, and that person in el barrio, in the context of the university, is now not as fully any longer, not as whole, you know, and then by the same token, as you get acculturated, which also means deculturated, so you have to be very careful about, you know, over, you know, acculturating students. You know. When you get acculturated in ways of being in the academic world, you find yourself going home and not feeling so comfortable any longer in the ways things used to be and the friends you used to have and so on and so forth. So this cultural drama, and also a linguistic drama, needs to be understood, and I think it requires a different type of teacher to do so. I say redefine bilingualism, because you cannot have bilingualism without biliteracy, you see? And by having biliteracy, you also must insist that in the process of becoming biliterate, you know, you will only succeed to the degree that you have emancipated. I say that, you know, with some emphasis, because just recently in ARA in Chicago, we're trying to think of a title of a new journal about Freire for Chapman University, and I suggested something something that has to do with emancipation, and somebody else suggested reframing education, and I said maybe reframing education for emancipation. And a liberal colleague intervened and said, oh, emancipation is so last century. Emancipation is so last century. As I had given a talk in UMass Amherst about 10 years ago, a colleague, very liberal, aggressively liberal colleague came to me, oh, your talk about social justice is so 60s, you know, as if the 60s, you know, the social justice, we solved those issues. That's to show you that we have to remain vigilant. For a scholar, for an intellectual to say that emancipation is an issue of the last century, you know, I would welcome that person to walk with me, you know, in certain neighborhoods, or in fact to witness what happens in Brockton, Massachusetts, where 120 families are homeless, living in cars, in shelters, or on the streets, and yet the kids go to school, to see that some of us may have emancipated, but not all of us. In fact, billions of people in the world have not emancipated. So that struggle is a process. It's not an arrival point. To be more precisely, as Stuart Hall said more eloquently than I could ever do, it's a process through which we, the oppressed, we find ourselves constantly, always in this postponed arrival. We almost get there, but we don't quite get there. You know, there's always a delay. And so, for a white person, perhaps they have arrived, but for us, not. So then, I want to talk today about bilingualism as reframed by the students in this conference, you know, about voicing your bilingualism, about the openness to multiple worlds, and their pedagogical commitment in becoming another being in a different language. Because when you learn a second language, you are not only learning, you know, a vehicle of communication, you're learning how to be in another language. You're learning how to be in another culture. You are, even when you don't realize, you are being, you know, changed in the process of becoming. So that is constant, and that needs to be understood. And as our reminder, a speaker for that author, Sayop, and again, termed us one more time, you know, we used to be left limited English speakers, limited English speakers for our students, but would never use that term for American students, middle class, while learning French or German or Italian, referring to them, she is a limited French speaker. She is a limited German speaker. We say they are bilingual learners, or if they do two lines or three languages, we call them polyglot. So this added value, the subtractive value in us. So I find out in this meeting that, you know, we have such a thing as long term English language learners versus short-term English language learners. All these categories. So I got up, I said, I am one of those. I am a long-term English language learner that by accident of history, I became a distinguished professor of English in the English department, even though I continue to speak with an accent from my country. And the very professor who was most supportive of my work in the English department was the very professor when I came to his classroom without speaking English that well, and I asked him for help, and he didn't want to really spend time with us. And he won a 40-page paper at the end of the semester after reading six novels, the first one being One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, I never forget that. Although I understood the argument, I understood the plot, I was able to do critical analysis, but I didn't have the language, the academic language, to express, so I sought his help. He had just graduated from Harvard, even had a patch on his coat. He got up with his pipe. I never forgot. He said, "Sonny, go learn English and then come take my course." Which he got totally deflated, this is during the Vietnam War, because we immigrated to the United States, so I didn't have to go to war in Africa where my country is fighting Portuguese colonialism to fight against our own people. If I were to drop out of the university at that time, 1969, I would have gone directly to Vietnam. So there was a lot at stake, and that's how I became Spanish major. And I'm very happy that I became Spanish major, because now I began to appreciate literature, poetry, another language. I got myself immersed in multiple literacies. Many, many years later, I end up in the English department. This gentleman changed radically. He was working mostly with ESL students, you know. And because I created a lecture series that brought Paulo Freire, Noam Chomsky, Howells, and all these major speakers through the West that Cristina talked about, you know, he thought I was the best thing that happened to the English department. So he was really supportive. And my colleagues, while I tell the story pedagogically, so we don't ever do that to anyone, see, they wanted to know his name, but I refused, it's not important, because the man had changed. So what I wanted to say to this woman in Washington, the author of PSYOP that some of you have to implement, you see, it's not only about structure, it's not about missing ED, it's about becoming this new language, it's about the process through which you can identify that behind the English language barrier, there's a human face with ideas, with dreams and aspirations that can in fact appreciate the literary text, can in fact develop argumentation, can in fact intervene with the text, interact with the text to create new meanings in the process of new meaning making. You know, but what I wanted to tell her is, as a long-term English language learners that we're now labeling some of our students, and if they don't do well, the problem is not the method, the problem must be with a student that needs even longer time to be a good English writer, an English speaker. Then I said, not only I am one, but this professor from Harvard, who had forced me indirectly to become a Spanish major, and now as a linguist I end up in his department, now we are buddies, he thinks a wolf of me. I am today, and I have done many, many times, corrected, edited his papers. And thus he is also a long-term English learner, this is it. So in a sense, what we want to do is how do we develop critical skills to begin to problematize labels that we don't deserve, labels that are used only to typecast us. And that typecasting is never to valorize us. That typecasting is to devalue, to demonize, and to dehumanize. And when you do that to youngsters, 7 years old, 8, 9, 10, so on and so forth, then I think we're able and stop blaming the kids for not learning, or for taking too long to learn English, and begin to really interrogate the loss of humanity of those who can engage in the demonization, dismissal, and devaluation of children all over the place. So this is basically what I wanted to share with you. But this conference would not have taken place And you would not have the Alexandras and her cohorts of the world without the necessary mentorship, without the commitment of colleagues of mine, Cristina Alfaro, for example, Karen Cardiero Kaplan, and I saw him, dear friend, who created this department, Alberto Choa, who even though he retired, he is still fighting, he is still struggling. And for Ochoa and many of us, there will be no retirement because there will always be struggles, and we have to be engaged in those struggles with your help because you represent the future. And I'm also very happy to be here to reconnect again with Antonia, who inspires me. I met her, she just corrected Cristina when he said 20 years, it's 30 years. 30 years, she said, 30 years, your time really fly. I met Antonia in the second Critical Pedagogy, the Five Power Conference in Irvine, and we have been friends ever since, supporting one another, and we both understand that was most important beyond Antonio and Donaldo and others is the political project. The political project, the principles of embedded in the political project is to create conditions, pedagogical spaces where our children who did not make a choice to come here, they were brought here. I did not make a choice to come. In fact, I didn't want to come and leave my friends behind. I had a good life, so I thought, in my country. To come here, we should be welcome in spaces where instruction will be less discriminatory and more just, less dehumanizing and more humane, along with Paolo would say, always. And I also want to say that the mentorship and the relationship that I've had with this department, it is precisely because Cristina, Karen, Alberto, and many others refuse to teach monolingually on their knees. They are not diminished because they speak Spanish. They are valorizing, they see that it is an addition that others could gain because the foreign language folks, you know, are spending tremendous amount of resources and not succeeding half as much as we are succeeding with the so-called, you know, ELL learners. So by not teaching on your knees, in a type of monolingualism, you see, we are, our students will no longer be tongue-tied in English, much less be tongue-tied in their own language. What I mean by that is that if you're not allowed to have access into the academic language where you become in English by mastering it, to write it, to read it, you know, to express your opinions in it. And then you are not allowed to develop the same literacy skills in your own language, you become doubly tongue-tied. You're tongue-tied in Spanish because you're not literate in it. All you have to do to say the nod is right, take a trip to Mexican City and try to speak it, you know, without being literate in it. You see how immediately a value judgment we made about your Spanish, you know, about, you know, the uneducated Spanish, so on and so forth, the same type of evaluation that we do in English. So, in working with Latino-Latina students, that more and more research are indicating there's a close relationship and cooperation and collaboration between what's been called the school to prison to grave pipeline. That when we basically force students that are out in the country for less than 6 months to take high stakes testing in order for them to be, you know, sent to the cold call proper, you know, instructional classroom, we are making sure that they are going to get discouraged, they're going to end up dropping out. When they drop out, they fall into the hopelessness of the streets, and then they get involved in, you know, small petty crimes, and with zero tolerance, even driving without a license, or even driving, you know, while intoxicated, will give you a record. With that record, you can't get a scholarship. With that record, you cannot get a decent job. So most likely, the system is inviting you to be part of that pipeline. And if you see who's in jail today, they are mostly our Latino brothers and sisters and our African-American brothers and sisters. So over almost 2 million individuals locked up in a country that goes to war, you know, to make other societies more democratic. It is the country that jailed more of its citizens. And our children are the ones going to jail. Thus, we have to work that extra hard to see to it that we intervene to break that chain, to break that relationship, as Bell Hooks would say, to rupture the process. So we go to school to end up, you know, in the academy, to end up, as Carlos Fuentes once said, to imagine these children not only as servers in our restaurants, not only as great pickers in our farms, but to imagine them as directors of theater production, to imagine them as architects, to imagine them as engineers, to imagine them as teachers, to imagine them as dancers, musicians, composers. This is what we have to imagine, and we have to excite and motivate our students. Together, we reimagine by reframing the very education that we engage ourselves in. And so this involves a lot of responsibility on the part of the teachers. I honestly believe that, as Johnson said, that teachers matter. And all of us would have a story here to share, but in my case, if it had not been a teacher, I would not be here. I'd be repairing your television. My guidance counselor didn't think that I had enough vocabulary in English, so my colleague also in the English department didn't think that I had to go learn more English to come and study with him. At that time, I didn't have the critical tools to say, I thought that you study English in the department, not in the Spanish department. I went to the Spanish department as a refuge. I was looking for a space where I could be understood, where I could be valued, where I could speak, where I could contribute. You see? All of that, because of the language barrier, was taken away from me. So thus, we need to understand that the education reform being put into place, an anti-transformative reform that deforms, so as to guarantee the reproduction of the prison to grave, the school to prison to grave pipeline, you see, now, needs to be not only interrupted, but we need to know the sources. The sources come from institutions and agencies and foundations like the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, or the Cox Brothers, that are investing millions and millions and millions of dollars to create more accountability, to create more testing, to create more militarism, and to create more zero tolerance in schools, you see? While the accountability of the society, of the politician, is never really in question. A society that generates poverty, a society in a city like New York City, you have 56,000 homeless people, and some of them working full time, but the money that they make is not enough to even afford an apartment, so they remain homeless. In a city of Manhattan, where restaurants, cheap restaurants, are selling, where these folks, our folks, are washing dishes and not making it, they have to live on cars, they're selling a chocolate dessert for $27,000. And New York Times is proud to announce that. You see, this is a city where it's something is happening. So if we cannot make people accountable, that you cannot engage in that obscene gesture of paying $27,000 for a chocolate dessert while you only pay $19,000 to your helper who's working 40, 50 hours washing your dishes, then something is really wrong. Thus, we are not just teaching the peasants eating. We are engaging with students to get them to realize who they are, what the options are, but to become aware. Remember, Paulo was not only about literacy. He used literacy to develop, to help, you know, peasants develop conscientization, which is a process through which you develop critical awareness of your environment, of who you are, your location, society, and your relation in the world and with the world. Then I want to talk to you today that in addition to stressing bilingual and dual language program, which I think is the way to go, which will guarantee biliteracy, critical biliteracy, I want to talk to you about another form of manipulation of language, which is the erasure of language. That some of us, many of us, get involved in that process without realizing that in not questioning the erasure of language, we are simultaneously producing the very values against which in our writing, in our position, in our contestation, in our denouncement, you see, we interrogate. For example, let's take the nomenclature that we often use all the time, and we hear it. I heard it in Washington the other day. Even though we have, I think, for the first time in many, many years, a highly progressive administration of ELA, and that this real dialogue, you know, I have tremendous hope, you know, that we're going to go somewhere this time around. But nevertheless, we're still working within the constraints of nomenclature, such as disadvantage. These are terms that I heard. At risk, I took notes. Low SES. But we never talk about high NCS, you know, in our research. Marginalized, disenfranchised, minority, limited English proficiency, English handicapped students, short-term ELL and long-term ELL, underserved, underprivileged. And I'm sure you can come up with another dozen or so. Now, think of all these labels that we want to tag on our students, one way or the other. And even when we discuss with our colleagues, with principals, with everybody, even when we are defending them, we are labeling them. So my point is, if we embrace the labeling, even if we are defending, we are undermining that defense by categorizing them with a label that typecast, devalues, demonize, and dehumanize. So we have then to create new ways of speaking about our students and ourselves, which is not an easy matter. What do I mean by that? What I mean by that is that for many of us, let me just pick on somebody. When you talk about, hello, you're in another world. When you talk about yourself, you refer to yourself as a person, how do you call it? Person of color, okay? When you do that, you see, let me find the applause. When you do that, you know, okay, thank you for volunteering. Your name?
Katrina.
When you do that, you're saying that Katrina, like, can I just exaggerate a little bit to make the point, you know, even though I don't know you. Katrina was a middle class, blonde, successful young woman, you know, then who's white. If you're a person of color, what is Katrina? A colorless, transparent Katrina? No. Can't be. So colorless white is a semantic impossibility, and yet we engage in it always. But the very transparency of whiteness, the very invisibility of whiteness, I'm talking about white ideology, becomes now the benchmark against which we then measure the gradation of color from black, real black, blue black, you know, brown, light brown, and so on and so forth, you see? So then that labeling process is not an innocent. So we as fighters, defenders of children who are children of color, we are all children of color, all including whites, because whites are color, we need to understand that it's not a color, a linguistic term. It is, again, an ethic, a racial and ethnic, you know, distinction-making process. So, but many, including myself, when I'm writing, do I say that I'm a person of color? Do I say I'm as a minority, man, or as an immigrant? But what I do not say, and if I would say anything, I would not say as an oppressed man, immigrant, then immediately I would not be read. Or my editor would basically edit that out. So you don't have them oppressed. But keep in mind that white is just as much a color as black, as brown, yet we know, Katrina, you never refer to yourself as a person of color. Tell me, do you?
No.
No, do you see how she said no with much authority? No, see, that is the point that I'm trying to say. So then, this erasure of language has impact on other things that we do. For example, we never talk about the ruling class in the United States. We don't have one. We live in a classless society. So they say. While saying that we don't have one, and the academy is the area that you're more censored for trying to use this category. See, if I have been edited and re-edited by my editors time and time again, that, for example, Lee has also, my partner has undergone the same problem, that when she says, as a subordinated, no, Chicana, you know, the use of subordination, you know, the white liberals find very offensive, you know. But if she had said, as a disadvantage, you know, Chicana, then it would be okay. So then we create euphemisms to talk about the obvious when the obvious we don't want to label or to even utter. So all these labels that I was taking notes in these various workshops and conferences in Washington, but I have been taking notes for many years, dozens of them, they all point to one thing. One thing that all these labels have in common, that they all express a state of oppression. But you cannot talk about oppression, because talking about oppression is being a Marxist, or creating a space where you be labeled a Marxist. For example, going back against the person that book was mentioned, I asked a colleague of mine in the English department that I thought was very progressive to write forward. When I gave her the manuscript, then another colleague came to me, very flustered, we need to have lunch, you know, and so, you know, to go over the manuscript. And the first thing she told me, Donaldo, why you and Paolo insist, continue to want to use terms like, you know, subordination, Marxist terms. I said, what do you mean by Marxist terms? I was young. What do you mean by Marxist terms? Subordination, oppression, ruling class. I said, what do you want me to use? Disenfranchise? Tell me, if Paolo had written the pedagogy of disenfranchise, would that be the same book? You know? Of course, then she became red in the face, red because she lost the argument, red in the face. Because it's a totally different ball game to have the pedagogy of disenfranchise. Because the disenfranchise use a syntactical rule, you know, that English professors should know, that remove the subject of the action. So to then create a space where the object can be blamed for, you know, for his or her own disenfranchisement. Whereas when I say the oppressed, I must have the counterpart, which is what? The oppressor. The two are in the dialectical relationship. But we seldom, very few, even friends of mine that I love to death, use, you know, right on, they celebrate the pedagogy of the oppressed, but then immediately move into disenfranchised, disadvantaged, long-term, all the labels. So this eagerness or this yearning for euphemism is part of the mechanism that I'm trying to figure out, of the very academic discourse that reflects a particular white middle-class ideology that erased the possibility that oppression, you know, could emerge as a topic of discussion. You see? So by not talking oppression, we don't have to deal with it. And if you don't believe me, go into San Diego Tribunal, I think that's the name of your newspaper. For 1 month, every day, if you find, you know, reference to oppressed people in San Diego County, I'll take you to the most expensive restaurant on my tab, because I am so convinced, I am sure they will not. But you will find in the discussion, you will find in the paper, you will find in the academy, you will find in academic journals, particularly in sociology, you know, low SES, so as not to mention lower class, so as not to mention working class. While candidates like Hillary Clinton, including some Republicans, even Ted Cruz, wants to campaign for presidency to defend the interests of the middle class, these same folks are saying we don't have class in the United States. And when you have a candidate, you see, you know, Sanders from Vermont, you know, pointing out to the inequality in the distribution of goods, economic and cultural goods, you know, and they will then blame him and attack him as wanting to engage in a class warfare. That class warfare began when basically you create hierarchies where people are located into jobs that they cannot even pay rent, you know, to have a roof over their head, a table to put food on, or to make sure they have food on the table, so then later on, they could have a dinner conversation, as Catherine Snow, you know, so passionately wanted to convince reading teachers that if you want Juanito and Johnny's and Maria's of the world to excel in reading, all you have to do is have a dinner conversation. A middle class exercise that for the 56, 6,000 homeless people in New York City, you know, who are some of them working full time, you see, they can't have dinner conversation because they don't have a home, they don't have a roof, much less a table, much less food to put on the table to have a dinner conversation. But if, let's say, hypothetically, they stumble into a one-bedroom apartment with a table, and they have conversation about the oppressed, the subordinated, the devalued, the demonized, the marginalized, and try to problematize, that's not what Catherine had in mind. The dinner conversation is a way of engaging, talking about the world, talking about events. The very, you know, talk about the trip to the museum, talk about the last symphony, you know, the cultural capital that we give, you know, spontaneously to our children, you see, and deny the lower class children. And then in your SATs, in your MCAS, like ours, MCAS, and so on and so forth, these are the test items that come up. So they are our students are disadvantaged because they don't have access to the cultural goods that get reflected, and they also they have been stripped of a language to talk about what they do not have. So for them it does not even exist. I don't know if you follow me, you see that language then is central to what we do. Because to talk about dual language program and not problematize the role of class in the developed dual language program, you know, we are only going to succeed technically, but we are not going to succeed to create conditions where in two language we become biliterate so as to be liberated and be emancipated. Because what determines the success of dual language in my view is the class position. The American parents that want their children to learn Spanish or French or Chinese, Mandarin or Chinese, so on and so forth, are middle class by and large, you see? And together with working, at least in Massachusetts, together with working class kids, now, and to me the model makes sense because at least they are interacted. In a city like Boston, which is hugely segregated, our children don't even have a chance to even see, much less talk and discuss, and find ways of being in the middle class reality because they locked into ghettos. They never go even to Denver. At least in the dual language program, there's the beginning of interaction, of talking, making friends, and seeing how the whites, you know, behave in certain contexts and so on and so forth. So there's a process of enculturation and acculturation, as Jim G. so clearly points out, that academic discourse is more than the grammar. It's a process to which you make meaning not only out of the words, but you make meaning out of the very world through which the middle class travels, you see? So to be able to identify the signpost that will allow you to make sense of your position in that relationship with middle classes. And it also happens that many of us, through education, will become middle class. Guess what happens? We also begin to abandon the value. We visit when we have a baptism in the family. We visit when there's a procession. We visit when there's somebody dies, you see? But we're no longer there. And our kids no longer know that reality. So there's a disconnect, you see? So you can reproduce middle classness because the openness after the Second World War with the civil rights created a small middle class Latinos as it created small middle class professorship and that salary that goes along and the other privilege. My daughters and my son cannot even fathom thinking to live in the neighborhood where I live, where they grew up, to go to school where they went to school, because the price is prohibitive. that because I have 5 minutes, I just want to add the end by that we need to pay attention to those voices, those emergent voices in our community that have emerged. We need to listen to Antonio, for example, to Cristina. We need to listen to poets like Gloria Anzaldúa. We need to read the Carlos Fuentes of the world. We need to really pay attention to the writing of Eduardo Galeano, who unfortunately died, you know, not too long ago. But going back to Gloria Anzaldúa that I use in my social linguistics class, even though she's not a social linguist all the time, we need to understand que el ángulo con la cara de inocente nos arrancó la lengua. So with this verse, she did precisely capture everything that I have said about you about language erasure. El ángulo con la cara de inocente nos arrancó la lengua. The angle with the innocent face, you know, yank away, you know, our tongue. Thus sentencing us to a colonized, you know, culture, and a silenced culture. And then she repeat, ahogados, escupimos el oscuro, peleando con nuestra propia sombra, el silencio nos oculta. Drowned in spit darkness, fighting with our own, our very shadow, we are buried in silence. That's what happens when we don't pay attention to the erasure of language. When we go along that we don't have a class society, in the entire education debate is about class, it's about inequality. It's not only about testing. If we talk about inequality, we talk about the class system, we see that kids in the middle of the class, kids, it doesn't matter how bad the teachers are, they are succeeding, they go to Harvard, they become your chief executive, your medical doctor, your psychiatrist, your theater director of the future. They have no problem whatsoever with those tests. So then I want to end by saying, to conclude, that the minority language has to be understood within the theoretical framework that generates it. Put another way, the ultimate meaning and value of the minority language, which would be Spanish in this case, is not to be found in the determined how systematic the rule governs. It is. It's not about teaching grammar, although we need to teach grammar. No. In the sense then, the student's language is the only means, in my view, by which they can develop their own voice, a prerequisite to develop a positive self-esteem. You cannot come to a positive self-esteem when we are yanking your language away, we are burying your culture, we are burying you in silence. So, to the end, I want to share a quote by Jean-Paul Sartre, a great French philosopher, that he said that according to him, the social disorder that we are now witnessing throughout the world sanctions the oppressed, sanctions the subordinated, sanction the marginalized, whatever term you want to use. Sanction the long-term ELL. Sanctions, you know, minorities. Sanction all the terms that I have used. You see, I quote to misery, chronic hunger, ignorance, in general, subhumanity, unquote. In essence, educators who refuse to transform the ugliness of human misery that we see as teachers, 120, like in Proctor, 120 families These children are homeless, they come to school. But as teacher, I do nothing, I say nothing, I don't intervene, I don't take action. I just teach, you know, A, B, C, you know. According to him, you know, social injustice, the ugliness of human misery, social injustice and inequalities invariably become these educators who don't intervene, who don't do anything, who in a sense develop conviviality with their ugliness. They become educators who, in his view, and so painfully he suggested, I quote, will change nothing, will serve no one, but will succeed only in finding moral comfort in Malays. Muchas gracias.